Good evening, everyone. We are in the middle of the days of the Omer, getting close to Lag BaOmer. I know there are people who are counting the minutes. The beer, the haircut, music. This is a period from Pesach. First day of Pesach end, and we start counting the Omer until Shavuot, 49 days altogether, which from them, if you take off the week of Pesach, you have really 33 minus 7, you have really 26 days that you don't have music, you don't shave, you don't have haircuts. You ask, what's the reason for this decree? Such a long period of time without shaving, without haircuts, without music. What's the reason for that? It's the, perhaps, the biggest tragedy in a Jewish history. Now I know what you're thinking. What are you talking about? We just had a Holocaust 70 years ago. 6 million. This is 24,000. When I say the biggest tragedy, I'm not talking in quantity. I'm talking in quality. What does it mean, quality? You have to know one thing. Every human being in the world has a price tag on him in Shamayim. Not everyone is equal. Of course not. You have the Jews, you have the non-Jews. Among the non-Jews, you have different nations. Some nations work more than others. And inside those nations of the Goyim, some Goyim work more than others. Some Goyim are righteous, some Goyim are wicked, some Goyim are idol worshippers, this is the worst. Some Goyim, according to the Torah, don't deserve to live a second. Every second they live, it's a wonder. How can they even live? Because all day they worship idols. And according to the Torah, people like this don't have the rights to live. Some Goyim, nothing wrong with them. Perfectly fine. Love God, respect Him, love Jews, don't believe in idols. Keep the seven laws. Beautiful, wonderful Goyim. They're righteous. They do exactly what God wants from them. So there are different levels of people. But we didn't come here to speak about different level of Goyim here tonight. We're here to speak about things that relates to us, the Jewish nation. So the idea is that when I say the biggest tragedy in a Jewish nation, I'm talking quality. What does it mean? 24,000 chief rabbis are dying in a period of one month, 1.5 months. There's arguments how long exactly it took. Can you ever imagine such a thing? Today, if you take all the rabbis in the world combined, there's a very, very big doubt, all of them combined, you took their knowledge. Bring me 10,000 chachamim. Beautiful, they know a lot of Gemara, Torah, they know Halakha. Some of them are really genius. Computer head. You get shocked. You say, this is not a regular person. This is a computer. You know, you remember thousands of lines, every page, where everything is in our generation. You take all of them combined as a very, very big doubt if they reach the level of Rabbi Akiva alone. If you put him on a scale, and you put 10,000 or even more on the other side, they can't even reach the level of Rabbi Akiva. The Gemara say, Katan Shebaem Mechayem Etim. Katan Shebaem. The smallest one in a level, I'm talking in Torah level, the smallest one can revive the dead person, can take a dead person. Yesterday they bury him, they cover him, he's in a grave already. He can take him out and revive him, bring back the soul into his body. You're not allowed to do it, but they had the knowledge, the Kabbalah, the mystical part of Judaism, they knew it like you know the way here, the streets, make a right, make a left, you do it for thousands of times, this is how clear it was. People today, many of them don't give enough respect or don't give at all respect to the Chachamim that are mentioned in the Talmud. One reason is they don't believe in the Talmud. No, what do you expect? They don't believe in the Talmud, they believe in the rabbis. There's nothing to talk about. But even ones that respect rabbi today, They don't have an understanding what does it mean etana or in amora. They don't understand. If they only learn one serious year in yeshiva and they saw their power in Torah, these people, and how holy they used to be, he will never dare in his life to ever question one thing that came out of their mouth. But today, people don't know what it is. People don't know who they are. They think, it's my rabbi from yeshiva. Yeah, I'm making him coffee, we sit, we laugh, sometimes we say jokes. This is in his mind. He thinks when he says Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, or Rabbi Akiva, or Rabbi Yochanan, when he says these names, he doesn't have an understanding that he's speaking about angels here, not people. It's not. These people were in such level that he cannot even imagine it. But with all the respect and the level and the achievement, what happened to them in the end? They all died in an epidemic. There was an epidemic. Five survived. Five. That's it. Five from 24,000. Beginning of the story is that Rabbi Akiva was cleaning horses. Cleaning horses. Where is he cleaning horses? In the house of the richest Jew, one of the three richest Jews in the world. In Israel, the Jews lived in Israel back then. So he's cleaning, brushing the horses, you know, fixing their legs. It's not exactly a graduate of Harvard, you know, to clean the horses. And then there's a princess over there. These stories, today, the chance that something like this would happen is 1 to 1 billion, if ever. But back in the days, I guess it was a different world. And we have that she see that Rabbi Akiva, he was Akiva, he comes from a family of converts. And he's Ama Aretz, meaning doesn't know how to read and write, doesn't know, you know, the language even. 40 years old. Some say he was married before with divorce, with a kid. Maybe yes, maybe not. It's not exactly a bargain. He doesn't know Torah, but she saw only one thing in him. One thing she saw in him. What is it? He was shy. He had manners. You know, when he got an order, yes sir, yes ma'am, yes, you know, polite. But she, all she had to do, she say, I want this chacham, I want this guy, I want this guy. They stand online, they beg. Well, I married Rachel, the daughter of Kalba Savua. Who wouldn't want such thing? Plus, her father, besides the fact that he was a very rich guy, he also knew Torah, he appreciated Torah. It wasn't just one of these rich people who never opened a book in their life. He has some knowledge. So what would prevent her from getting any guy she wants? From all the people you need, somebody 40 years old, doesn't know anything. His family, back in history, they're not from the nation of Israel. They joined them later. So many question marks over here. Out of nowhere, she told him, I'm willing to go with you. I'm willing to give up everything. My father, I know what's going to happen. In one condition, you go to yeshiva. Now, many people, I'm sure you heard the story. I'm not here to tell you anything new. I'm going to talk about things that you heard at least 50 times in your life, but I'm going to make it completely different than what you heard until now, to go a little bit deeper than what usually you hear, to get the picture clear. So back in the days, it wasn't like today. Today you send your kid to yeshiva, school bus, 5 o'clock, mommy, what's to eat? Easy life. Some take a phone, take a cell phone if I need to reach you. Very easy. Across the street, sometimes you can go and knock on the door, Rabbi, I need to talk to my son 1 minute. Comes out, you see him every day, no problem. You can go, even he goes to the dorm, even he goes to learn in Israel, he gets on a plane, come 2 or 3 times a year, wedding here, wedding there, bar mitzvah here, brit milah there, Pesach, Shavuot, Sukkot. Baruch Hashem, you need a whole month to work just to pay for his tickets. Baruch Hashem. But still, you see him. If he cannot afford for him to come, today, Baruch Hashem, you open the phone, Mommy, Tango, Skype, how are you? So life is easy today. But back in the day, when a woman, she's a princess from a billionaire home, very modest, very righteous, perfect. She takes a man like this, and she said to him, go to yeshiva. And going to yeshiva wasn't like today, you come next week. That means I'm marrying you, but I know already I won't see you. Because as soon as I marry you, the next day you go. So what's the point here? What's the point here? You may come and say, oy. Thank you. You may come and say, what's the problem that he would learn in town? It wasn't like today, you have yeshiva across the street. The Gemara say, Rav Kahana, it's fine. Rav Kahana said to his wife, they have a boy, his name was Salik. Salik, when he was young, first grade, his father wanted to send him away to yeshiva, meaning the next time they'll see him is in his engagement. That's how it was. You send your son to yeshiva, he won't come every 2 or 3 months. By the next, no telephone, no Skype, no messages, no messenger, no nothing. Next time you see him, if you see him, you don't know, the walls, robbers, things are moving, the yeshiva maybe escaped to a different place. You have no, what are you going to do? You're going to go now 3-4 months on a donkey to look for your boy? You may never see him. Huge risk. Send your boy to yeshiva was a huge sacrifice. Not like today, he's on the school bus. Maybe there's going to be a terrorist attack. It was much, much, much harder. So he goes now. So Rav Kahana said to his wife, I want to send him to yeshiva. And the wife was scared. She said, no, I want him to learn here. He said, but over here, it's not the level for him. It's a sharp kid. We have to send him to good yeshiva. She said, I disagree. Yes, no, yes, no. They want to get divorced. Fighting for the education of the kid. It's not a joke. They came to the rabbi and a bet din. Rabbi, what should we do? I want to send him to yeshiva. She doesn't let. The rabbi asked her, why you don't let? She said, I can't live without my son. I can't. Some women are more sensitive. They can't. He says, so, but you don't care about his Torah? I care. He can hire a teacher. He's going to come and teach him in a house. And that's what the rabbi say. Can you hire someone good to teach him Torah? I say, yes. So he taught him Torah in the house. How many years? 25 years. Until he was 30 years old. 25 years, they don't come out of the home all day, from morning to night. They learn. One day, the Rebbe come to the father of Kahana. He say, I don't want to steal your money. I'll be honest with you. The boy knows everything I know and more. What's the point? He doesn't need me. He can learn everything he wants. He's already an independent rabbi. Doesn't need a teacher. Thank you very much. Hashem bless you. Goodbye. Now Rav Kahana didn't see nothing. His son, Salik, he comes on the street. He begins to walk. He comes to the market. Somebody said lemonade. You know, like in Israel, they scream, lemonade. They have a boot. No, fresh homemade lemonade. He said, how much? 5 shekel. $1.50. He said, you know, I'm a talmid yeshiva. I'm a bachur yeshiva. I don't have money. Maybe you give me for free. Lemonade, 5 shekel. For free? Why for free? It's my business. He said, you know, I'm a bachur yeshiva. I just learned for 25 years in a room without coming out. First time today I walk in the street since I was a kid. I didn't even know about the streets, nothing. First time I see the street, you won't let me get a glass of lemonade? He said to him, good for you. You learn Torah, good for you. What do you want from me? Over here is business, Habibi. Cash on the table. So he got very angry, this boy. He came back home. He walk inside the house. He takes his jacket off. He throw it on the couch, whatever. So what happened? His father and his mother got very nervous. He say, why did it help me all these years? I killed myself to learn Torah, learning. I didn't go to college. One friend of my friend is a doctor. My other friend is a lawyer. The other one is an engineer. The other one has a store in 47th Street. They all, Baruch Hashem, have money, cars, everything they want. And look at me, I cannot even buy lemonade. Why did it help me all this? His father was clever, Rav Kahana. He wanted him to relax first. He waited a few hours. Once he relaxed, he said, come, I have a diamond, very special diamond. I want you to take a paper and a pen. Pen was a feather. Go to the market and evaluate the diamond. Ask people to make you an offer. Write all the offers and the name of the people, and we will sell this diamond. We're going to have enough money. Don't worry. We're not poor. I kept that for the days that you're going to graduate your learning. So he went to the Shuk HaKarmel. You know Shuk HaKarmel? Shuk HaKarmel or Shuk Machane Yehuda. Watermelon, you know, they all scream. So he comes to the first one, he sells tomatoes. Did you see such a diamond? Whoa, nice. I want to sell it. You interested? How much? Make me an offer. $50. $50? Okay. He writes, watermelon boot, $50. Came to the tomato, how much? How much he gave you? Mr. Gavrielov, how much? He said, $50. Okay, no problem. 75. He writes 70. 100, 120, 175. Come to me, come. 300. By the end of the day, sweating all day, he got to $1,000. So happy. From $50 to $1,000, these guys are crooks here, offering me $50. He came to his father. He said, I made a great progress today. I started at 50, I came up to 1,000. His father is smiling. So don't worry. Tomorrow I'm sending you on the subway to 47th Street. You're going to go, Mr. Borokhov, Mr. Fakhlayov, Mr. Teherani, Mr. Cohen. You go over there, Mr. Rosenblatt. You go to all these people over there. You show them the diamond and make them make you an offer. No. That's all I want. Second day and nothing else. After that, you can do whatever you want. So, okay, I'll go. Kibudav. He went to the booth. He comes to the first one. He looks at him. His eyes came out. 350,000. Excuse me? 350,000. The boy, he writes it down. Comes to the next one. 700,000, easy. 700,000. Comes to the next one. 1.5 million. What's going on here? $50, 1.5 million. He writes 1.5. In the end, $7 million. $7 million. He comes to his father shaking. He says, Abba, I don't get it. I didn't know we're so rich. So the father said to him, let me ask you a question. You're a clever boy, right? You're not a boy. You're 30 years old already. Tell me, I want to ask you a question. Why did I waste your time yesterday sending you to Shuk HaKarmel? This guy, tomatoes, water, $50, $75. Why? I knew that over here they'll offer you a lot more. Why did I send you over there? I wanted to show you in this world there are people who knows to evaluate diamonds because that's their business, and people who thinks it's glass. So they're offering you $50. I don't understand it's a special diamond. You have to make a big hole in the ground and go with the truck, and it takes a year until you get to it, and finally you get lucky. They don't understand this. So this is the way the world is. When you came to this foolish lemonade booth owner and you told him, I want lemonade for free, if he knew the value of someone that learns Torah, he would grab your beard and kiss it and kiss your hands and kiss your feet and bow down to you and say, please, please, I'm begging you. Every time you want lemonade, you don't need to ask. You come, you drink the whole thing. Whatever you want for the rest of your life, promise me you come. Please, I'm begging you. No, I just want one glass. No. Please make a neder. Every day I want you to come drink lemonade. No. Please, I'm begging you. Why? I have a little crumb from your Olam Haba. You come, you drink lemonade by me. Such a big chacham, tzaddik. At least something will help me in Olam Haba. What helps me right now? Sell Muhammad lemonade? Sell Mustafa lemonade? They're not going to take me to heaven. This is the world we live in. People who understand what Torah is, they'll give their life for it. Like Chacham Ovadia, Chacham Ben Zion, Rav Eliashiv. Nothing in the world they cared about. Rak Torah. people who doesn't know what Torah is. Even you pay them $1,000, they don't want to come learn. Come, pay you $1,000. No, it's too hard for me. I can't come. Why? They don't understand what it is. So going back to our story. Rachel, she said to Rabbi Akiva, when he was Akiva, I marry you in one condition. You promise you go to yeshiva. By the time they got married, the father cut her out. She sent him to yeshiva. No telephone, no nothing. She's alone in the house, very poor. He made her a house from straw. He took straw, he put it together with some water. He built her a, if you can call it a house. She's alone, lonely. The neighbors make fun of her. After 12 years, he came home. As he was about to enter, he heard that the neighbor makes fun of her. You're gonna die here old. Nobody cares about you. Your husband already, who knows, maybe he married another woman, he forgot about you. And Rabbi Akiva listened to the conversation. So she answered, if I could, I would send him for another 12 years. As long as he's learning Torah, I'm good. This world is nothing. The next world is what counts. When he heard that, he turned around and he went and left for another 12 years. Something is a little bit strange in the story. Yeah, you hear the story, but you have to ask some questions over here. What husband will do such a cruel thing? 12 years he did not see his wife, newlywed, even Sheva Brachot they didn't have. He came back after 12 years, a normal man that did not see his wife for 12 years, and he loved her, and he loved her very much. Very, very happy to marry her. So he came after 12 years, he wouldn't come home to spend the night, and tomorrow morning goes for another 12 years. It's a little bit cruelty here. If today would happen such a thing, you'd be able to call someone like this a rabbi? Say he doesn't have mercy on his own wife, he can have mercy on his student? What's the secret over here? Why he didn't come in for one night? The answer is, the Gemara says, 24 years straight learning without a break, it's not the same like 12 plus 12. What is it like? You take the teapot, you fill it up with water, you need 10 minutes to boil it. You put 5 minutes, you boil, you almost, you know, it's beginning to bubble, you take it down for a minute, and then you put it for 5 more minutes on. Will it boil? No. You took it off, it gets cold. You put it back on, it goes back to what it was. You did not achieve a lot. If he would make that break, he knew everything will go down, he will get cold, maybe I'll wait another week. Right away, he went back to the yeshiva. 24 years later, now he's 64 years old. He now has beard, he became white, he comes, and 24,000, imagine this, 24,000 people follow him on the street. And she came, she probably also was close to 60 years old. And she gave up the palace, the servants, everything. She comes like this. They kicked her out. Hey, what's wrong with you? You don't come where the rabbis are. Go to the kitchen over there. Go. No, let me see. No, get out of here. All of a sudden, he saw her. Very nice drama, this story. Call her. All your Torah belongs to her. Everything you ever learn, she's the boss here. Thanks to her. Without her, why? Because when she told him, I want you to go to yeshiva, in the beginning he agreed. But then the next day she said, no, why did we get married? For you to go to yeshiva. And he said to her, how can I go to yeshiva? I'm 40 years old. They're going to put me with little toddlers over there, 3 years old. They already know Aleph Bet. I don't know Aleph Bet. I'm going to sit with my beard, 40 years old. There was no Gillette yet. So I was 40 years old, beard probably all the way to here, sitting with the little kids. Aleph, Patach, Aleph, he's 40 years old. He has to go with the kids. It's a little bit embarrassing. I wanna take a guy today that never went to yeshiva and doesn't speak Hebrew. Somebody from the community. Mr. Cohen, I wanna put you in pre-1A. Pre-1A, you sit on a little chair. And with the Rebbe, you repeat after everyone. No, do you know one person would agree? Especially if somebody will take a picture of it. So what happened? He refused to go. So she told him, I want you to take a plant, put it on a donkey, and walk with the donkey all the way in the market, back and forth all day. He said to her, what? She said, just listen to me, trust me. He started to walk, everyone laughed at him. Look at this meshugineg with the donkey like this. The kids, the people, they're laughing at him. Everyone laughs at him. He said, why is my wife planning such a thing for me to laugh like this? Everyone laughs at me. The next day she said, go again, go again. All week he was walking like this. What's the point? First day, everyone laughed at him. Second day, 80%. Third day, 70%. Fourth day, 40%. After a week, nobody laughs at him. Hey, Akiva, what's your name? Come sit with us. Here, have coffee. Nobody laughs at him. They got used to him. Even today, first time someone not 100% in his head come into the shul, you know, he does, makes faces, he does all kinds of things, everyone gets a little nervous. A year later, he's already sitting next to the rabbi in a mizrach. Come, come, Moishale, bo. Right? Everyone got used to him. Nobody gets intimidated. Who is he? He's already here, one of us. We got used to him. She told him, 1 week they'll laugh at you. After that, everything will be fine. So he went, and that's how it was. Now, what made Rabbi Akiva do tshuva? Before he became Baal Tshuva, he wasn't a regular, secular, traditional chiloni. He was a very, very anti. He could not stand the rabbis. He couldn't stand the rabbis. He heard the word rabbi, he got goosebumps all over his body. How do we know? Because when he became a very big rabbi, he told his student, he wasn't embarrassed to tell who he was. He said, when I used to walk on the street and saw a rabbi, I was thinking to myself, I wish I can bite him a bite of a donkey. So his student told him, rabbi, a bite of a dog, not a bite of a donkey. He said, no, a bite of a donkey. He said, why? He said, dog, when he bites, he makes a few holes, but he keeps the bone complete. When a donkey bites, he cracks the bones to pieces. There's no way ever to get it back. That's how much I hate the Torah. The Gemara say there is a rule in the world. And I can tell you from experience, this rule is 1,000,000% real. The Gemara say there is a rule. An ignorant Jew has very strong drive and motivation and desire to hate Talmidei Chachamim. When he sees someone that knows a lot of Torah, the way he dresses, the way he talks, it kills him. It's allergic. He cannot even hear it. The Gemara say, and the wives of the Talmid of the Amei Aratzot, even worse. When he comes home, he says, this guy annoying me all the time. Torah, Torah. The wife said, she got even crazier. She said, no, you're still too nice. This is a rule. Of course, there's always an exception to the rule. Some ignorant people, they respect very much Rabbi. Rabbi, please come to my house. I'm begging you, sleep one night, come. Fine, there are people like that. But the general rule, like you see today, one of the conditions before the Mashiach would come, the Gemara say, that the people will hate the tzaddikim. Someone sees someone that lives according to the Torah and is completely different than his lifestyle, he cannot stand him. That's why on Facebook, on all over the internet, non-stop Lashon Hara. Any rabbi you ever heard his name, there's Lashon Hara about him in the internet. Even the biggest, the holiest in the world. It never ends. So what's going on? How can it be such thing? So there are people, they say, listen, I'm not religious. I'm not interested to be religious. But for me, the rabbi is the second God. I give respect. I'm not interested to be like him. But I appreciate what he has. I know he learned all his life. He comes. I give him respect. Doesn't mean that I'm going to be like that. But respect I give. But some people don't care anymore. Going back to Rabbi Akiva. After 24 years he came, his father-in-law came, he said to him, tell me, when you made your vow, if you only knew that your son-in-law one day will be a rabbi, would you still ban him from all your wealth and everything? He said, of course not. Even if he knew one Mishnah, a little bit Torah would already not cut him. He didn't know even Aleph Bet. How did she do such thing to me? He said to him, your neder is canceled. Your vow is canceled right the way I'm your son-in-law. He gave him half of his wealth. That's the first time Rabbi Akiva became wealthy. Up to 64, he was very poor. 64, that's the first source that he became rich. Half of the richest men in Israel, right away went to him. Overnight, he became a millionaire. But there are four more sources how he became rich. Found a treasure. He married a wife that converted of the Roman Caesar. She brought all the treasure from her minister, her ex-husband. There were a few different places Rabbi Akiva made fortune. How many years he lived? 120 years. One of his main students is Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. This is what we're here tonight to speak about, like Ba Omer, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. After the 24,000 Talmidim died, five left. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was the main one there. Why 24,000 holy, such holy tzaddikim died? How can there be such tragedy? Each one is equal like 10,000 other people who doesn't know Torah in his holiness, in his knowledge, in Shamayim. It's not a simple thing. It's the biggest spiritual tragedy in the history of the Jewish world. You have to understand, if you ask a Jew today, what's the worst tragedy in a Jewish history? They'll tell you everybody right away, the Holocaust. Why? Because they remember it's 7 years ago. We hear about it all the time, still fresh. The blood didn't even dry. And everybody knows 6 million is a huge tragedy. Not that many Jews know that when we came out of Egypt, 12 million died. Double. Why? Only 20% came out. 80% that did not have faith in Hashem, they say, I want to stay in America. Mashiach is in Jerusalem. Finally, I built myself a $5 million in Rigo Park villa with the lions. You know how much I imported the marble from Italy. This Mashiach come and ruin my plans right now. Finally, I bought next door. We expand the boot. Gonna bring some more gold and jewelry. What Mashiach? He couldn't come next year. I didn't even pay my expenses. That's exactly what's going to happen when Mashiach comes. Many of the rich people will say, excuse me, Ben Ishai, can we make a deal with you? Just name how much money you want us to collect. We'll send you the money. Timchal lanu, bimochel, ma. We're just growing. We just build a shul. We renovate the place. Come on. That's how it's going to be. What do you think? People's going to run, leave everything. Mashiach, let's get a little tiny apartment in Yerushalayim with no elevator from the 1850. Not exactly going to be so easy. So, the Torah started from zero. Mamash, almost we lost it. Five Talmidim, they started, build it, and today, 2,000 later, we have Torah. The question is, why 24,000 died? The answer of the Gemara is scary. Lo nahagu kavod ze baze. They did not respect each other enough. Of course they did. The giant chachamim. They gave respect. Not enough. Why? Because I'm chacham, he's chacham. We're not hold of each other so much. We're used to each other. He knows everything. I know everything. Everyone knows everything here. Big deal. No. You can know the whole Torah. When Rabbi Ovadia Yosef was a young boy, big Ashkenazim rabbis that were already in their 80s, they rise when he came in. They ask him, what are you standing, Rabbi, when this Faradi boy comes in? He said, this Faradi boy one day will be Gdol Ador. But one day he will be Gdol Ador. But right now he doesn't know 10% of you. You 80, he should rise for you, not you for him. They already knew the value of Talmid Chacham, even though they were much greater. Why? This is the right way. So they did not respect each other enough for that 24,000 got wiped out. This is the reason why we don't listen to music and all certain things that we don't do in the days of the Omer. Then Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, let's hear a little bit who was Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Thank you. No, it's the lemonade boot. Let's see, what is the special day in Lag BaOmer, the 33rd day of the Omer? First, we know the story that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai wrote the Zohar, the Kabbalah. All the Kabbalah we know today is based on the Zohar. Two people influence the Kabbalah world the most. Who are they? Two people that without them we would not have Kabbalah today. Basically, no one would hardly know what it is. Two people. One, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, and the second, the Arizal, the Ari HaKadosh. If the Ari did not live or did not tell us about the Kabbalah, and no one would know anything. It was mamash like a messenger from Shamayim to tell the world about this. What does it mean, Kabbalah? The mystical part of Judaism. The mystic part. When did Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai wrote the Zohar? First, he was in a cave for 13 years with his son, Rabbi Elazar, in Meron, eating carobs and drinking water. An angel was teaching him. They didn't have clothes. You don't have clothes, 13 years. Clothes wear off. They hung it on a tree. They dug a hole in the ground. They put his body up to here. And they were covered with sand to here, and they're learning. They didn't come for Namash, preparing a pile of carobs. Carobs, did you ever eat carobs? If you still have your teeth by the time you finish, it's like trying to buy this wood with a little bit of sugar in it. And seeds inside. On top of everything, seeds inside. It's like cutting the stomach, like knives. 13 years to eat such food, put your hand one day in sand. By the time you remove the sand, see how dry your hand's gonna be, all cut to pieces from, it's gonna be very dry. 13 years like this, when he came out, his skin was all cut. From the tears, the salt would fall on, burning. How did Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai end in a cave? You cannot learn Torah with the air condition, with nice, beautiful building. I have to go in a cave. The story was, famous story in the Talmud, the Romans were already in charge in Israel back in those days. The Romans killed his rabbi, Rabbi Akiva. They killed Rabbi Akiva. When Rabbi Akiva was in jail, why he went to jail? Because he was teaching Judaism. He was teaching Torah in the public, what we call today on Facebook. He was teaching. But they warned him. The government says it's illegal to teach Torah in Facebook. It's against the law. If you're going to get caught spreading Torah, propaganda, Torah, 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 not only we take your page, we put you in jail. Like it used to be in Russia. But a lot more cruel. So Rabbi Akiva, one guy came to him, Papus, he said to him, you're not afraid to teach Torah? Don't you see that Hashem put these Romans, the kingdom, they're in charge, they made laws. Why do you teach Torah? You're not afraid? So he said to him, you know what you like? It's like the fish in the lake, and the fox is standing over there, he tried to hunt the fish, and he see that the fishermen, they try to catch the fish with their nets, so the fish are running in between the nets, and the fox tells them, my buddies, come here. Come, I'll take you to the land. I'll help you out from the nets of the fishermen here. So the fish answer him, you fool. In a place where we are expert to maneuver and to run away, and we are alive inside the water, we are struggling to live. You want to bring us to a place with no water that will be dead for sure? Why did Rabbi Akiva told him that story? He say, right now, the only thing that keeps us alive is the Torah. Now we're going to stop teaching Torah, no Torah. The Romans will take over. No Brit Milah, no Rosh Chodesh, no Shabbat, no Tefillin, no Torah. Two generations, Torah is finished. No more Jews, no more nothing. War to die for it. So one die, another one will die, 10 will die, but the Torah will spread. They give up. They see we're not giving up. What do you think the Christians did 500 years ago? They decided to destroy Judaism by force. Spanish Inquisition and Spanish and Portuguese. One every 10 Spanish and Portuguese goyim in the world has Jewish DNA. Meaning they either Jews or they mix with Jews. One of the two. One out of 10, which I'm talking many millions. Not to talk about the rest of Central America, South America, who knows how many. Many of them has a strong attraction to Judaism. I get emails from these kind of people a lot. They already know the world. We are Anusim. Anusim means our parents were forced to give up Judaism by force. They used to torture the Jews in a basement of the churches. They used to give them all kinds of tragedies, to rip their stomach apart. They used to tie their hands and their legs and roll it and roll it and roll it with big wheels like this until you hear the spine cracking. Pregnant women, they used to do horrible thing until the Jew would scream, I become Christian. Soon as he scream, I'm giving up Judaism, I become Christian, right away they take him off. Come, mwah, mwah, I will love you. The religion of peace. That's how it was. They made a lot of them go in. They were afraid. They hide in a house to try to keep some mitzvot. That's it. Eventually, one or two generations, they lost. So Rabbi Akiva told him, you want me to stop teaching Torah? This is a moment we got to give our life for the safety of the Torah. This is the test. Later on, they met together in jail. They're in the same cell. Papus, that was kissing up to the Romans, politician, and Rabbi Akiva. What we call today the politically correct rabbi and the real rabbi. Both of them in the same jail now. He was kissing up to the secular, to the goyim, to the cruel, those who hate Torah. What happened? He got them angry once, they put him in a jail. Like some Jews think, if they'll be nice to the world and this, if there's going to be another Holocaust, God forbid, that they care that they were nice. They live in a dream. So Rabbi Akiva said to him, why are you here? He said, why are you here? He said, I'm here because I taught Torah. And he said, I'm here because of nonsense, business, politics. So he told him, Ashrecha dat nitpasta al divrei Torah. Me, I'm here like a fool. At least I'll give my life for the Torah. They'll kill me for the Torah. At least I have olam haba. Now I was a stupid politician. In the end, they'll kill me anyway. At least you can come, Arugei Malchut. You come to Shamayim like a king. Why am I dead? Because I gave my life for the Torah. But what am I going to say? Why am I dead? Because I cheat in a business. And the goyim caught me and put me in prison and they're going to kill me. So when they took Rabbi Akiva, first of all, they didn't kill him right away. They waited for the opportunity. He was in jail. One day, a student brought him water. Every day was bringing him water. So the soldier saw that there's a little bit too much water. He kicked it. Half of the water spilled. The student picked it up, and he came late. Rabbi Akiva was an old man, 120 years old. He said to him, why you came late today? Don't you know I depend on this water so much? He said to him, today they checked me out. They didn't let me come. They spilled half of the water. This is what they were holding me. So Rabbi Akiva said, okay, I understand. Thank you very much. He was about to do Netilat Yadayim. He didn't drink. He said, well, Rabbi, what are you doing now, Netilat Yadayim? Drink the water. It's more important to wash your hands. He said to him, what can I do that my friends, the chief, the community, the rabbis, the committee of the rabbis, they made a decree that every Jew must wash his hands before he eat bread. Why? Why the Jews have to wash their hands before they eat bread? What happened if your hands are clean? Clean. All day had gloves. Now you took them off and you want to eat bread now. Why do you need Netila? Oh, man, you check my hands, not one germ on it. All day was namash, cover, everything, and then touch anything, no germs, no nothing. Still have to do Netila, why? The answer is, after the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed, the Chachamim made a decree. When the Kohanim goes inside to eat, they have to eat the bread inside Beit HaMikdash, they have to do it with pure hands. One day, the Chachamim already knew, if we're not going to make decree that all Jews have to wash their hands before they eat bread, when the Beit HaMikdash will be rebuilt, nobody would even remember that you cannot eat the bread without washing the hands. Why? Everyone already take the bread and eat. So we make now a law that all Jews will wash their hands automatically, that the Kohanim with the future to come for sure will also do it. Otherwise, it's all worthless, the service. So in order to prevent one day such a problem, they already saw it coming. They say all Jews would wash their hands. Besides, it's always good to wash their hands before you eat. One day the Chachamim saw Rosh Hashanah is 2 days. Sometimes it falls on Shabbat. They say you're not allowed to blow the shofar on Shabbat. Why? From the Torah you're allowed. You need to, from the Torah it's an obligation. You have to blow the shofar on Rosh Hashanah. First day Rosh Hashanah, Shabbat, you have to blow the shofar. Hachamim say, you don't touch the shofar on Rosh Hashanah, Mukzeh. Why? Maybe one day a Jew that blow the shofar will forget to bring it to shul on Rosh Hashanah. Whoa. He didn't bring it before Shabbat. So now he's going to have to run and carry it on the public. He will hide it under his jacket because he's embarrassed. Now everyone is waiting for the shofar, 500 people. Now they're coming, shofar. Where is the shofar, Moishale? I lifted it on. Finish. Who's going to marry his children, this guy? His life is over. So the Chachamim already knew, what is he going to do in a case like this? He said, you know what? I'll be mechalel Shabbat and not to get the embarrassment. Because there's nothing that a human being is afraid more than shame. There's everything the person can tolerate besides shame. You tell a person, listen, let's say he has $5 million after 20 years of hard work. You discover something about him and you say, I'm going to publish it in the internet or in the newspaper against you tomorrow. The whole world will know about it. You'll never be able to show your face ever again. Unless you give me $4.5 million from what you saved. 20 years of work. Otherwise, everybody will know. Your children, your wife, your brothers, your parents. Disaster. The neighbors, the rabbi. Horrible. He has a choice. He'll give them right away the money to prevent the shame. Shame, it's a more painful punishment than physical pain. What's the proof? Did you ever see a boxing match? Mr. Jackson against Mr. Williams. They hit each other, no, for 40 minutes. Boom, 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 boom. One of them fall. Let's say Mr. Jackson fell. So now as soon as he hit the floor, what does he hear? Whoa! All his fans are disappointed. So the referee begins to count. 10, 9. What the people that always got knocked down, what's the first thing on their mind when they're about to die in 5 minutes from now? Before they die, they have one more thing to do. What? They don't say Shema. There's only one thing they want. They grab the rope, they stand on their feet, and they go like this. What are you, fool? You're going to die in a minute. Don't move. Every move is going to make you paralyzed. It goes like this. And everyone clap. And it relaxed the shame. You see? I'm not so defeated. Here I come. I stand back in my feet. Big deal. He knocked me down for a minute. It's not a complete knockdown. Why? The shame is a killer. So, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, he was like this. No politically correct. That's what Hashem said to do. His opinions were very solid. For instance, he said a person should trust Hashem, should not work at all. You trust Hashem, he'll do everything for you. What is this to waste time on going to work? But there was machloket between him and Rabbi Ishmael. He said, no, half a day you have to work, half a day you have to learn. Half a day you have to learn, meaning 9-10 hours a day. Not like today you ask someone, you're working or you're learning? Half and half. 12 hours in 47th Street, 50 minutes in a yeshiva. Half and half. But in the times of the Rambam, Rambam writes, Ba'ale batim learn 9 hours. Like a yeshiva bachurim. Ba'al batim. He goes to the boot, works a few hours, comes right away to yeshiva. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, they started an argument between him and Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Yehuda. They say, Rabbi Yehuda say, wow, look at this empire of the Romans. They made such beautiful roads and bridges and all these parks. They're making the place so advanced. Wow, look, a mall over here, a market over there. Rabbi Yossi didn't speak. He didn't agree. He did not disagree. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai said, don't be naive. Everything they do for themselves. They do it for us. Why do you think they make roads? Because they want to collect tolls. when they made the bridges here in New York, what was the first statement they made? It's only to collect until we pay for the highway and for the bridge. By now they pay for the whole world already. Not only for the bridge. When I was in San Diego, they took me to the President's Hotel. It's a place where all the presidents of the United States used to go there. So you see Abraham Lincoln, Truman, all these famous names. Some of them with horse, a carriage. You see how they came there back in the days, right on the beach in San Diego. It's a little island. It's a fancy hotel. All the president, each one has a corner of his own, how he used to sleep in that hotel back in the days. I went there, I have a friend, he's a judge. We went together over there for Melava Malka. you know, grab something to eat. So we went over there, and then I see there's a toll there, but no one was there. Come on the bridge, little bridge. Where is the booth? Close. I said to him, why? They don't collect toll in late at night? He said, no, they closed the tolls. I said, why? He said, they finished to pay for the bridge. I said, that's only here in New York, it will never happen. In New York, they go back, they still owe more and more on the bridge. Every day goes up. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai say, everything they do for themselves. Don't be naive, enough with this kissing up to this Reshaim. Right away, a son of a convert heard that. Yehuda ben Gerim, his name was. Son of converts. He still had half of his heart with the new Jewish nation that he joined them recently, but half of his heart was still with his old nation. So he is half enough. Half religious, half what he used to be. So he ran to them. You have to know one thing. Why people run to the police and to the government to tell them about others, their own brothers? I want to ask you a question. Today, if they offer $1 million price to turn in a Jew, the FBI is looking for a Jew, you know where he is. They're offering $1 million price. How long would it take until somebody would call and give his location?
1 second.
1 second? Before they hang the flyer, is going to be already in handcuffs. But how do we know that back in the days it wasn't like that? How do we know? Esther. Esther was Persian, right? Persian Esther. Okay. Farsi Miduni. So Esther and Mordechai said to Esther, there's no choice. You have to go with the Achashverosh. There's nothing we can do. But Esther never told him she's Jewish. How many years Esther was in the house of Achashverosh and not one Jew went to Achashverosh and said, Your Majesty, I have inside information from you. You're going to kiss me. I'll be your adopted son. The wife that you just married, she's Jewish. She's fooling you. It's all a scam. Give me $1 million, I'll tell you who she is. Nobody told. And Esther Magedet Moladeta. Esther doesn't say where she's from. Imagine this, you marry a girl, 5 years, where are you from, honey? None of your business. You don't want to say where you're from? She didn't say. Maybe she's some Persian. Whatever. Nobody told. Why people would tell? Why? Why to be cruel? Not to have something against her. They want the money, ma. I want the kid, the king, to know that he owe me a favor. We buddies now. He will always remember that I'm loyal, I came, I told him the secret. No? Not one person did it. But today, unfortunately, in Israel, they put an 800 number. It's called Malshinon. You heard that or not? Huh? You didn't hear? Malshinon. Everyone that will call the Israeli IRS and tell about one of his brothers that is hiding tax money will get 10, or if I'm not mistaken, even 20% of that they will collect from him. Instead of making unity in a nation, they turn everyone to killer, that everyone will murder each other for money. It's like a father that has 2 sons, and he has enough ice cream in the fridge. And he said to them, you want ice cream? Fight for it. They kill each other, bleeding here. No, what a smart father. This is what they do. They want some money all day. Hello? Yeah. Well, my name is such and such, but off the record. I have information for you. I used to work for this guy. He's not always paying. This is what's going on. You cannot trust your son. You cannot trust your son-in-law. You cannot trust your partner. You cannot trust the neighbor. You don't know who it is. This is the cleaning lady over here. Maybe she's going to hear something. Like this, I don't think Mashiach is coming. Think for a minute, if Mashiach would see such thing, why would he want to come? Think for a second. If they tell Mashiach, Ben Ishai, you have to go. He would say, I'm sorry, I don't want. To who exactly would I go? To this guy that just turned his brother yesterday and is in jail? To the other one? To this one? To this one? To the one that writes in the internet and murder people? I have a whole lecture about it. Murderers with pen. Now we should change it. Murderers with keyboards. So now let's see a little bit who is Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and why so many Jews go like Ba Omer to Israel, take the kids, cut their hair, dancing in Meron. One thing you already see. There is no bigger yortzeit than Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai in the whole Jewish world. Yortzeit means the Memorial Day. Every year, 500,000 people go there. Some of them go a week in advance to put a tent to be close to where they put the big fires, all the rebbes. A week in advance, they take off. 1 week picnic. Why? That when it starts, they'll be close. Otherwise, they'll be very far. 500,000 people, it's a lot. You look at all the prime ministers of Israel, Ben-Gurion, Begin, Rabin, Golda, whoever you want. Go today to their grave on the yortzeit. Nobody. Not one person there. Maybe a cat. Meow, meow. Cat. Nobody. No, I'm not joking. Menachem Begin is a prime minister that most Israeli admire and loved very much. He was even Shomer Shabbat, I believe, from what they say. Was a decent person, was a warrior. One of the people who released Israel from the hand of the Arabs and the British, gave his life for the country, became a prime minister, was ethical, no corruption ever was involved with it. After the war in Lebanon, he got so depressed from what happened with soldiers dying, he closed himself for a few years, depressed in his home until he died. Didn't want to go out, to be in front of the camera. Mamash, a decent person. Today, a decent person like this, even today, doesn't have people in his grave or minyan. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai is 2,000 years ago. How people still remember? Every year, more people go. This is what the Gemara say: Tzadikim gdolim b'mitatam yoter mi b'chayehem. When they pass away, they're even greater than when they were alive. How many people, when they were alive, like the Ramchal? Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, one of the biggest Kabbalists in history, a huge, sharp Talmid Chacham, which was also a diamond maker, was working for his parnasa, didn't take from tzedakah, whatever. 250 years ago he lived. When he was alive, everyone tortured him. You're not allowed to teach Kabbalah. Who are you? You don't even have a beard. Look at you. You look 18 years old. What is this? An angel is talking to you. You dare to tell us these stories. The rabbi put him on a ban. Wasn't allowed to teach. They made him sign that he cannot spread his books, nothing. They threw bathroom in his face. Horrible life he had. He died 38 years old with a broken heart. And as soon as he passed away from the world, the Gaon Mivilna got the book, Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just, to his hand. Original copy in handwriting. As soon as he looked at that book, he put his Shabbat clothes. He said, where is this Chacham live? I'm going to walk with my Shabbos clothes all the way to see him. They told him too late. A few days ago, he passed away. But the statement of the Gaon Mivilna, in 1 minute, published him to the world. And today, does anybody would have something to say against his books? It's legend. With Judaism without it, it's like a person without a heart. You cannot learn Judaism without Mesilat Yesharim. You don't understand the concept. Actually, today I went to a Brit, two Britot, one in the morning, one a little bit later. There was an old man in his 80s. If you remember a few months ago when I spoke there in Englewood, New Jersey, he argued with me a lot for maybe an hour about the world, how it was made, an older man, American. And today he came to me and he said to me, tell me, I want to ask you a question. By now, he already believed in God. Back there, he wasn't sure who is God, who made the world. Now, he's already speaking like half religious, Baruch Hashem. And he said to me, why God made us? I said to myself, what a great progress. 3 months ago, he was screaming at me, how do you know there's a God? Who made the world? A random explosion. Now, he's already beginning to talk to the point. So I said to him, the first page on the Mesilat Yesharim, Path to the Just. He had to see his eyes. Combination of joy and tears was falling from his eyes and say, great answer. You're the only one who was able to answer. I asked so many people, everyone gave me a foolish answer. I said to him, that's a very simple thing. It's the first page of Mesilat Yesharim. You were asking people who didn't know. And every Jew in Yeshiva knows it. He's beginning to explain why Hashem made the world. Why? The source of good wants to share what he has with others. You don't have who to give the good. What's good? What good is that? You have it by you, and you alone. There's nobody to give it to. You need to create someone to receive. You need receivers. A person who made $100 million in business and cannot have kids. Every week that passed by, he suffered more. His bank account growing, and his heart is broken more and more. Why? Who am I going to give all this money? I don't have what to give. He would agree to give $99 million to get one kid that he can spend the last million on him. Why? That's the nature of the world. You have something, you want to share it with someone you love. But there's always an exception to the rule. The pen. So let's conclude. Let's at least get... We get at least... the conclusion of what's this whole Lag BaOmer and where it came from. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai lived in the time of the Romans in Jerusalem approximately 2,000 years ago. It was the fourth generation of the Tanaim. One Tanaim and another generation of Tanaim. Then later came the Amoraim. Then came the Savoraim. Then came the Geonim. Then came the Rishonim. Then came the Achronim. It's generation of Chachamim. So remember, there was Moshe Rabbeinu, there was the old Shivim Skenim, the 70 elder people, and then the Sanhedrin, and then later on, Anshei HaKnesset HaGdola, and then it started to go. No, there were prophets before Anshei HaKnesset HaGdola, the Nevi'im, and then the Nevi'im passed it, and he went to Anshei HaKnesset HaGdola, and to the Tanaim, and to the Amoraim, and to the Savoraim, and to the Geonim, and to the Rishonim. Who's the Rishonim? Rashi, Rambam. Look how many waves already. And Achronim, and today it's Achrone Achronim. Achronim was already 500 years ago it started. But today, 500 years later, it's Achrone Achronim. The Chachamim that we had today in the last 100 years. Okay, so now... He lived 2,000 years ago, was one of the five students that survived. And although the Romans were trying to destroy those five, and they made strict laws against spreading and teaching Torah, the Torah was in a great danger, God forbid, to lose it for good. They sacrificed their life to pass the Torah to us. And what some of us do with that? Put it on the shelf to accumulate dust. Our fathers gave their life that we're not going to lose what Hashem gave us, and we put it and play a game on a computer. You have the Torah right there. What do you do, Moshe? There's a game. What? One person came to me saying, Rabbi, I'm so upset. What? The Spurs got lost. I said, what Spurs? What do Spurs? San Antonio Spurs, the champion. You should see how he was crying. I don't think he was crying like this for the 24,000 Chachamim that died. Somebody take a piece of leather, he missed. The Jew is depressed. Cannot learn Torah now, a week. He needs a break. So it says like this. When the Roman heard that Yehuda ben Gerim told them that Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai speaks against them, they came to look for him. He was afraid that his wife, they'll torture her and she'll tell them where he's hiding. So what happened? He took his son to an unknown place that she won't even know where they are. And they went to Meron and they hid over there for 13 years. Today, the same place where they were, this is where they buried Rabbi Shimon and Rabbi Elazar. Rabbi Shimon was there for 12 years. So why we say 13 years? Because after 12 years, they came out, him and his son. They came out and he saw a farmer is plowing the ground with his axe, making lines. He said, Ozvim chaye olam v'mitaskim b'chaye sha'a? How can it be? He couldn't believe what he's seeing. He said, what happened? Look at this guy! Instead of learning Torah, he's wasting his time making lines on the ground. Well, he's a farmer, what do you want? He couldn't believe how people would be so foolish to give up treasure for nonsense. He gave such look to them, they burned alive. That's how holy they were. Hashem put them back in a cave for one more year to reduce their holiness. How do you know that a person that reached a very high level of holiness, his face become fire? Where did we see it? Moshe Rabbeinu. When Moshe Rabbeinu came down from the mountain, he had to hide his face. From the light of his face, they couldn't look at his face. It was blinding everyone. The fire of the Kedusha of Mount Sinai, Moshe Rabbeinu's face was like a ball of fire. Karnu panav. You know, the Goyim, they teach that the Jews have horns. If you go to Texas, to some old villages, you know, when some cowboys are coming, one cowboy came to a bar. He came to a bar, he parked his horse outside, he comes inside, say, give me a pint of beer. They give him the beer, he comes outside, the horse disappeared. He comes back inside, guys, where's my horse? Nobody pays attention. So he said, I'm giving you 10 seconds to bring back the horse. Don't make me do what I did in Arizona last week when my horse disappeared. 5 seconds later, the horse returned. So he gets on the horse, the barman asking him, excuse me, out of curiosity, can you tell us what you did in Arizona? He said, I walked 5 hours all the way home. So now, you know, that cowboy, so he went on a horse, his son came join him. So you see those 3 Indians over there? This one, I want to kill him. He said, which one? He said, the one on a horse. He said, all 3 of them on a horse. He said, the one with the feathers. He said, Dad, they all have feathers. He said, the one with the bone and arrow. He said, they all have bone and arrow. He shot both of them. He said, this is the one I want to kill. You don't understand the easy way. You get the heart of it. What doesn't come from the head, come from the legs. So now, so Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Eliyahu HaNavi came to the cave and told them, you can come out. The Roman Caesar that was looking for you, he died. And there is a rule. Once the king is dead, all the requested fugitive have automatically a dismissal. It can start from, you go out automatically. Baruch Hashem. So they came out of the cave, they saw farmers, they looked at them, they got burned. Hashem put them right back in and said, listen, you came to destroy my world. You're in a very high level. You cannot live with ordinary people. He took them back, he lowered their kedusha, and after 12 months, they say, Tzu mima'aratchem. They heard a voice, now it's time to come out. They came out, they saw people still working in the field, they felt horrible, but they can control themselves this time. So, they saw one person goes with adasim. You know adasim that we smell? Or when we have in Arbat Aminim? He said, what are you doing with these 2 adasim? He said, I'm preparing them for Shabbat. So, why you have 2? He said, one for Shamor, one for Zachor. The Torah, one time in the Ten Commandments, it says Shamor et Yom HaShabbat. One, it says Zachor et Yom HaShabbat. One for Shamor, one for Zachor. He said to his son, you see, look how the Jews love the mitzvot. One for this, one for that. He had a, Baruch Hashem, a peace of mind. Then, he started to teach Torah and was the biggest until the last day of his life. Before he passed away, the last day of his life, he gathered all his students around him and he told them about the holy Zohar. The question is, where was the Zohar until then? There was no Kabbalah in the world? Moshe Rabbeinu didn't know Kabbalah? David HaMelech didn't know Kabbalah? All the other Nevi'im, they didn't know Kabbalah? The answer, of course, they knew. But the one who gathered everything together into one book was Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, and that's the Zohar. Who really wrote the Zohar? His student. What was the name of his student? Rabbi Abba. He is the one who wrote it. And Kabbalah, not every person can learn it. Today, they made a business out of it. Jews, non-Jews, Shomer Shabbos, not Shomer Shabbos, people who know how to read Hebrew, people who doesn't know, people who doesn't even know what they live for, all of a sudden it's in style, Kabbalah. Today when I was in the Brit, there was one woman over there, convert. So she said to my wife how she converted. She heard that Goya singer going to Kabbalah, and she got curious. She started to Google what it is, and she found one rabbi, Baruch Hashem kosher one, from Monsi, Orthodox rabbi, accidentally. She was looking for where the singer goes. And she ended up with a rabbi, started to learn Torah from him. You know, they don't know what Kabbalah is. Every Torah is interesting. Oh, it's very interesting. For them, it was Kabbalah. And then eventually, from here to become a Jew, the way was very, very short. Why Jews light fire on Lag BaOmer? Where this custom came from? What's the connection between the death of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai to lighting fire all over the world? And throw marshmallow into the fire. That's an American edition. Where does it know? Anybody knows? Nobody knows? Why are we lighting fire on Lag BaOmer? Here, no?
Signaling?
You first raising your hand and then you begin to think. You first have to think, then you raise your hand. All right, don't mix the order. Very good. The answer is, the answer is, because Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, the Romans, were blaming him for all kinds of things and they wanted to kill him. But he was hiding and all kinds of miracles that happened to him. Eventually, later on, they were making fire on the mountains to spread the news. It wasn't like today, you put a message on Facebook and everybody knows after a minute that they have to come in Cairo, in the center, and make a revolution in Egypt. It wasn't like that. If you needed to pass the news, you had to make fires on a mountain. That's how they announced that it's Rosh Chodesh. They made fire here, and he makes fire over there, all the way to Syria within hours. There's no telephone, no way to check, no way to do anything. So why they stop at one point if they were announcing that Rosh Chodesh by lighting fire? So why they stopped? Because the liberal Jews came on purpose to light fire one day before. Why? They wanted all Jews to eat on Yom Kippur. They can't see Jews keeping the laws of the Torah, some of them, not all, some of them. So they wanted to confuse the Orthodox Jews. So they light fire a day before. So now the Jews in Syria, they see fire a day before. The Bedin, only in Israel, they announce Rosh Chodesh, not out of Israel. That's the halakha. You have to do it, it has to be done in Israel, and then they send messengers. So when they saw light in Syria, they assume Today it's Rosh Chodesh. They count 10 days, Yom Kippur. But actually they counted from a day before. So on the 9th of Tishrei, everybody fasted. And the next day on Yom Kippur, people were eating. Why? That's how they used to fight the religion. What do you think? There's anything new today? Back in the day, they fought the religion with fire on the mountains. Today with Facebook. Or other things that they put on the internet. Olam keminago noeg. Olam keminago noeg. The end of that, you should know one thing. From all the chachamim, one of the greatest chachamim that mentioned almost in every page, every chapter in the Talmud is Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. In the Gemara is mentioned as Rabbi Shimon, as Rashbi, sometimes as Rashbi, most of the time just Rabbi Shimon. Everybody knows Rabbi Shimon, Rabbi Shimon. This is what's going to be, this Lag BaOmer. Now the question that many people ask, Rabbi, should I take my son to Meron to cut his hair? I heard it's a very big mitzvah. How much you going to spend on that mitzvah? $1,500 ticket for you, $1,200 for your little kid, maybe some other wife or another kid would want to come, say $4,000 or $5,000 to go give him a haircut. So let me chill you out a little bit. First, you should know the whole things of growing hair for little kids, it's not even a law. It's not an obligation. It's just a nice custom, tradition. Not an obligation. If a person has a baby and his hair growing and he cuts his hair, he did not violate any rule. It's not an obligation. You cannot complain to him. You cannot make a comment. Hey, how come your son is 1 year old and you already have short hair? I'm not interested to raise his hair, and one day to wait when he's 3. Where did this custom come from? Because the Torah says when you grow a new tree in Eretz Israel, 3 years you don't touch the fruit. You let the tree become strong, the fruit growing. After 3 years, you begin to cut. First 3 years is Orla. Fourth year is Orla Tareva. It's not so simple. It takes a few years until you begin to enjoy. But by the third year, you cut his hair, you cut that fruit. By the third year, somebody thought about a nice custom. Let's leave the hair of the babies and cut it by the 3. But it's not in the Ten Commandments. But I know Jews, they will kill for that. They have to do it in Meron. You don't have to do it in Meron. You have extra money. Why not? It's always good to go to the Holy Land. Move there, better. You cannot move there. You can always go there. You don't have an obligation to go in Meron. If for whatever reason that week you have something, wedding here in New York, you cannot go, you want to go a week later, you can go a week later. It's not an obligation. Even to cut the hair doesn't have to be on the birthday of the third birthday. Well, it's not Pesach. Leila said it has to be on the 15th of Nisan. No. You know what's going on today in the world? Most of the Jews, they don't know to tell the difference between mandatory and obligation to extra tradition, extra additions. The additions and the extra, that is not an obligation, and if you don't keep it, there's no punishment. They're willing to die for. But the things that they have to give their life for, they throw out of the window in a minute. Who can give me an example? One person say, Rabbi, I have a problem. What's the problem? I didn't keep chametz to sell to the goy. I said to him, so it's very good. So your house is clean from chametz. Yeah, but what am I going to sell to the goy? I said, it's not in the Ten Commandments that you have to go, Muhammad, come, I have something to sell you. It's not in the Ten Commandments. It's only a trick if you're stuck with expensive chametz. Muhammad, come, give me $1 down payment, take my chametz. Come back to visit me in 10 days. No. They think it's an obligation to sell to the goy. No. Better not to have chametz. You don't need to sell to the goy. Clean the house, get rid of the chametz. I know if you're Persian or Bukharian, it's not possible because you have a lot of whiskey. Whiskey is expensive. Fine, you sell it to the goy. But somebody who doesn't like whiskey doesn't need what? For a little spaghetti, sell it to the goy. You understand the point here? To sell chametz to the goy, it's not an obligation. It's if you're stuck with expensive chametz, they find you earn around it. But some people, they'll kill for it. He goes and buys chametz that he can sell to the goy. Oh, we ran out of chametz. Why? Nobody teach them what's obligation, what's the law, what's extra. They don't know. Sometimes a person that goes with the extra, if you do not do the extra, he calls you wicked. The Saba Minovardok, he had a yeshiva, and one boy decided to keep Shabbat 1 hour before Shabbat starts. 1 hour before. Shabbat starts now at 7:45. 6:45, he's already ready, he's accepting Shabbat on him. He pray mincha early, he keeps Shabbat. But the rest of the yeshiva, they still prepare, do laundry, whatever they do. One day the Rosh Yeshiva calls the boy and he say to him, listen, between you and me, isn't it a shame that you're the only person in my yeshiva that respects Shabbat so much? You start Shabbat an hour early. Look at them, a minute before Shabbat, they're still on the phone. There's no phones back there. Or something else. Isn't it? He said, yeah, Rabbi. Isn't it? Look at them. No, you don't feel bad for them. Say, yeah. I feel bad for them. You're right. Not one person here is mechabed et Shabbat like me. The rabbi told him, I command you right now to stop doing it. You're going to start keeping Shabbat a minute before the time, not an hour before. Rabbi, I thought you're happy. I tricked you. But why you tricked me? He say, it's very nice to accept Shabbat an hour earlier. It's not an obligation. It's very nice. It's nice chumrah. It shows that you love Shabbat. It's not a burden. You're not waiting for it already to be over. It's very nice. The rabbi told him, I wish all Jews would do it. But someone who does not do it did not violate any rule. If you keep extra, and another Jew that did not agree to keep more than what the law required is a criminal in your eye. This extra that you keep make you lose a lot more. Better you don't keep, because it's all a show of ego. It's a lot of strict people. Strict! Where can we be strict? All a show of. Put him in an island 1 week, you see what, what is he going to do. One woman came to me and say, am I heard your modesty lecture. I have to tell you, I disagree with you. I say, which part of the lecture you disagree? You say that women that put tons of makeup and, you know, and the clothes and this, and they go on the street because they want the men to look at them. I disagree. I do it for myself. I like to feel great with myself. I say, beautiful. Let me ask you one question. He said, yes. I said, let's say you are on a plane. God forbid the plane landed somewhere in the middle of Zimbabwe, I don't know, in an island. And now you came out, everyone kaput, and you survived with your makeup box. You walk around the island, elephant make you a face, the monkey, oh, you know, a little snake over here, a deer over there. Walk around, not one person in the island. You have your mirror, you have your makeup, everything. I want to ask you a question now. Now there's no people on the island. That's it. You're alone there. Would you still sit half an hour? Would you do that for who? For the chimpanzee? You got me. It's all a show. You do it for yourself. You do it for yourself, you'll be on the moon, you still do it. You do it for the men. And sometimes you may be not even aware of it. It comes from the subconscious. The Gemara say, and back in the day, the tall girls, what they used to do? Nothing is new. What do you think? The world was, the lack of modesty started today? I mean, today it's a lot worse than what it used to be. But back in the day, a tall girl, she had to make sure she had two friends that are midgets. That everybody would see when she walks in the middle, compared to them, how tall she is. So from the Gemara you see that 2,000 years ago, a tall girl was making a show off. Not only that, the Gemara said there was one girl that she walked, and the Roman soldiers, they went like this. Psh, And she started to walk even more, you know, like in a fashion show. What other thing they used to do to attract attention? They used to put bells on their legs. Like today you put for the goats, for the sheep, when they move, you know they're about to run, gling, gling. So they used to walk with the, you know, when they walk, automatically a person hears bells, automatically turns around and he looks at them. Ay, 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 ay. Nothing is changing. Just, you know, in a different version. Yeah.
You mentioned about Rabbi Akiva, who's in prison, and he didn't continue.
Shem Tov, you surprised me. Baruch Hashem. Very good. Maybe I should attach you with me. So well, we have one loose end here. So we started to say a story that Rabbi Akiva was in jail and his student came to him. And he said, what are you going to do? He said, I have to wash my hands. He said, drink. You're an old man. He said, what can I do, my friends? The rabbis made a decree that you have to wash your hands. And that's how Rabbi Akiva made Netilat Yadayim. Then when they took him to die, they were making lines of blood with metal brushes all over his body. Try to imagine such a thing. Chas v'shalom, God forbid, that the Hamas will take a big rabbi, 100 years old today, there's few holy ones left in the world, and put him in Tel Aviv with all these Mustafas with their guns and all these masks screaming, Allahu Akbar, you know, to the camera like this. And God forbid, try to imagine the tragedy. They take knives like this and take the old man like this and make lines of fire on his body, and all the Jews stand around and they're all screaming and crying. Try to imagine such a tragedy. And Rabbi Akiva, in case you didn't know, is the greatest Jew in the history. The greatest Jew in, basically the greatest person in the history. Why? Why is the greatest person? Moshe Rabbeinu was before him. The Gemara says, Moshe Rabbeinu, one time Hashem brought him on a mountain because he did not allow him to enter Israel. And he showed him in a vision all the generations that would live in Israel. And then he saw Rabbi Akiva giving a shiur in Ocean Parkway, 550 over there. And Rabbi Akiva was teaching and teaching, and Moshe doesn't get half of what he said. Doesn't understand. He's teaching Torah. So Moshe said to Hashem, I don't get it. Why you chose me to give me the Torah? He's much smarter than me. Look, he's teaching things that I don't even know. In the end of the shiur, Rabbi Akiva say, everything I taught you today, Baruch Hashem, we got from Moshe Rabbeinu from Har Sinai. But he developed it. Same thing. So when Moshe Rabbeinu saw the end of Rabbi Akiva, he said to Hashem, this is what a person that gave his life for the Torah deserved to get. This is justice. Moshe was arguing with Hashem. Why was the answer of Hashem? Shh, be quiet. This is how it came to my mind. Kach ala b'machshava. The Gemara asked, what does Hashem say to Moshe, be quiet? Give him an answer. What does it mean, be quiet? Somebody asks you a hard question, you tell him, sit and be quiet? Answer him for the question. He asks you a good question. How a tzaddik like this should die in such a horrible death? So Hashem said to Moshe, you should know one thing. The ordinary people, since their ability is very low, I judge them according to the level of the world. If the world is loser, I judge them like loser. That's what it is. But the great people, the great souls, I'm not putting them in the same category with the ordinary people. They're in a very, very high elite league. I judge them based on their soul, their potential. Strict. No mercy. One mistake, it's enough. The student of Rabbi Akiva say to him, you can kill all of them with Shem Amforash. At Khan, they say to Akiva, what are you doing? Do something, they all die. He had the ability. So he answered them, and we'll finish with that, and then we give you time for questions. He answered them, all my life I say, ve'avta et Hashem Elokecha v'chol levavcha v'chol nafshecha v'chol mo'odecha. You should love Hashem with all your heart, all your soul, and all your money. For the first time in my life, I have this opportunity to finally do it in actions, not in words, like a robot repeating it millions of times. Now it's an opportunity to give my life for the truth, and now you want me to stop it by a miracle? And when he said, Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, his soul came out, and that was the end of the story of Rabbi Akiva. And it's connected to the Omer. 24,000 of his students, Hashem judged them just like he judged him. Very strict. Even Moshe Rabbeinu couldn't believe when he saw his end. 24,000, one mistake, they did not survive. One time you disrespect your friend, not enough. In our level, if somebody like that, if today somebody would a little bit disrespect his friend, nobody would make a big deal out of it. No big deal. Come on, I don't care. But in their level, Hashem is so precise with this tzaddikim. It was very close to lose everything, but Baruch Hashem, we got saved. This is the celebration of Lag BaOmer. Thanks to people like Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, we all got saved. Any questions about what we spoke, what we didn't speak? Any questions? Now is the time. Yes.
How come Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, when he got out, and he had the koach, how come we didn't go and destroy all the people who were tormenting?
You know what's the difference between us and the real big Chachamim? We right away, when we have a problem, we want to destroy it. The big Chachamim don't go and interfere with the world. Not everything right away, you have a problem, you go and you kill, or you say all kinds of miracles, and the people fall and die. No. When Hashem sent them, there was a reason for it or no? He sent all these goyim to give us our time to fight the Torah. That's what Hashem wanted you, to have a test like this. You don't eliminate the test. You have to pass the test. Everyone who comes and give you a hard time right away, you eliminate him by saying the Shem HaMforash. It doesn't work like that. In the end, where are the Romans today, Shem Tov? Hashem erased them from the face of the earth. Where are the Romans? Besides few Tonys and Vinys in Rome, nothing is left from them. No? You come to Rome. You see any Roman over there? No, you only see a few Italians that make good, delicious pizza. And they know how to play soccer, that's all. More than that, they have any connection to the Romans? Nothing, nothing. You see, the gate in Rome with Titus brought the menorah, with the slaves, they brought the menorah, and it's in the Vatican, under the ground. Soon Mashiach would come, we'll get it back, Bezrat Hashem. But other than that, what do they have left from the Romans?
Question. You mentioned about the ladies who, they want to, look nice. But we allowed to say to a believe wives, and it's a general question, a lot of people asking this. If we're allowed to say, we're not going to make upset, to tell him why you're doing, when you go to the wedding, you go to Barbies or something like this, you look nicer than you stay home or you'll be coming outside, like let's believe, to walk on the park. We're allowed to
help all this,
or
no? Yeah, in a nice way.
Nice.
With no anger. a person has to speak to his wife sometimes like she's his little daughter. You speak to a little girl, you give her a lot of compliments and attention, a candy maybe, And then, you tell her, between you and me. Not with an angry approach. If you come with an angry attack, I'm going to show him. She will even go to the wedding of Mustafa just to get him back. Do you know what they do by the Hamas? I saw something I can never believe I saw such thing. They show on YouTube a film that the Arabs made a wedding in Gaza over there. Men, hundreds of men in one place. Women, the other side of the moon, over there. Women dancing, but they don't show in the camera. Only they show the men, the Mustafa, when they dance, they like to shoot. All of a sudden, two jeeps came. Yeah. They play music, Arabic music. Men only. Wedding. Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Kill all of them. Their own brothers. You know, in some Arab countries, when women go to the beach over there, how do they go? They don't go with bathing suit. They go, you know, with the blanket. Do you know what they do to them? They put mines under the sand to scare them that if they walk on the beach, every step can be an explosion and she lose her legs. To their own, it could be a sister. If my sister go over there, let her explode.
Good.
That's what they do. You understand? But that's not what the Torah say to do. The Torah say to speak to the ladies, speak to their heart, that they will be more modest. Because it's very strong Yetzer Hara for them, especially in today's world, when the level of humanity in general is so low, it's a very hard test for them. Sometimes you wonder, why does she care if it's going to be a little bit above the knee, the elbow, or below? What is, she fights for it. The knee has to be mamash on the line of the skirt on the line of the knee. A little bit like that, below. It's going to make any difference? You can see that she fights for it. She is willing to kill for it. That the skirt has to be tight and exactly. Why is it? Satan drives them crazy. For us, it looks silly. Like this, what difference does it make? This is kosher, this is not kosher. But for her, it's a World War III every day.
If she's not understanding, you tell her so many times, she doesn't understand this. Still continue to talk to her like a kid?
So what do you suggest, to give her two? I see where you're leading me to. Tomorrow, new headlines on Facebook. The Israeli rabbi strike again. Suggestion, give your wife two.
I think it's too much.
I want to tell you one thing. One girl went into a jewelry store, 7 years old. We'll finish with a story. 7 years old girl, she walks into a jewelry store. The Israeli salesman look at this little girl. Try to imagine, 7 years old, like this cute kid over there. Little girl, what does she know about jewelry? She comes into the store and she say, I want to buy this bracelet. It's $1,000 shekel, $260. Gold bracelet. So they say to her, you have money? Where is your mother? She said, my mother died. So how did you come here by yourself? I came to buy my oldest sister a bracelet because she's getting married soon. She's engaged. We decided to collect money, all the brothers and sisters. And she took a bag, take it out, all coins. Coin, shekel, 5 shekel, 10 shekel, coins. He opened the bag, he counts the coins, 200 shekel. But it cost 1,000 shekel. So the girl, he said to the girl, she said, we collected, this is what I like, I think she's going to look very nice with that. 7 years old girl. The salesman felt very bad, orphan. She wants to buy for older sister who raised her. She is the older sister, she's like the mother. He couldn't tell her no. He has a Jewish heart. What can he do? He packed it nicely. He gave, be very careful. Here, put it, hide it here. Go give it to your sister. He gave it to her and he took the coins. The next day, the girl came, 20 years old girl. She showed up. She said, I know exactly what happened. My sister came with some coins here. I want to return it. You can give me back the coins. It's fine. He said, well, what's the problem? She said, I know the coins wasn't enough to cover for that. I don't want to enjoy from charity. I want to return it. He said, no. The girl paid me the full price. She said, I know what they had. 1 shekel, 2 shekel. They couldn't be. This is an expensive bracelet. So the salesman told her, since I work here for so many years in the store, this is the only time that someone actually did pay me a full price. So she said, what do you mean? He said, people that come to buy jewelry by me, there's people that have extra money. They have homes already, they have cars, they have, so they want to burn money on jewelry. What else people would burn money on jewelry? If they need it for food, food comes before a bracelet, no? So that means it's luxury already. They have extra money. No, let's burn 1,000 shekel. It's no big deal for them. The first time a person walk into my store and put everything he's worth on a piece of jewelry was here. Do you want to take away this mitzvah from me? He refused. Anyway, the coins, I don't know how much it was. It's already in a cash register. Take it. Mazal tov. Goodbye. Little kids, they thought about the sister that raised there. They went and got her a bracelet. One time there was a big criminal in Israel. He wanted to rob a jewelry store of a Hasidish man. The gang, they say, you want to join the gang? You have to prove to us that you're capable. Here is the store. You go there with a gun, you rob him, and you bring us everything. So he comes in, and he's very nervous because it's the first robbery that he has to make. And the religious man, the Hasidish, was a very nice, sweet man. He looked at him, that's very nervous. He said, can I help you? Who's machste yid? So now, he already spoke to him, so he doesn't feel comfortable to pull the gun. So he looks at him, he says, well, can I help you? He said to him, you know, I was looking for a job, I cannot find a job. They begin to talk. So no problem, I'll help you out. Maybe I can find you a job. How can he rob him now? He doesn't know he came to rob him. He begins to talk to him. How can he rob him now? But then the gang is afraid of the gang. So he said to him, I'm going to help you. You look like a good man. You come work for me. I'll give you some cash. You go, I'll tell you what to do. You take some jewelry, you sell. You make commission. He came to rob him. The Hasid didn't know what he's getting saved from. So what happened in the end, after that, he gave him the cash. The gang heard that he didn't rob the store. They came the next day and robbed everything. But he, the guy, because of this whole story, he actually went and got the police involved. They got them on time with a big suitcase full of everything. And everything went back to the Hasid, and the Hasid only in the end found out that he came to him to rob him. But he was extremely nice to him. You know, in Bnei Brak, there's a place they sell silver. One woman comes in with a baby. She said, how much is this big menorah? They say 100,000 shekel, $25,000. Big, silver, nice, handmade. They said, my husband is waiting for me in a car. I think it's exactly what we're looking for. Can you do me a favor? I'm going to hold my baby for 1 minute. My husband is double parked. I'm going to show it to him. If he likes it, we'll give it. Hold my baby 1 minute. She took it. She came outside. 1 minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, nobody comes back. The saleswoman, she's holding the baby already 10 minutes. It's not so pleasant, you know? She came outside, no double park, no nothing. All of a sudden, she see a woman run on the streets in Bnei Brak screaming, anyone saw the baby that was here in the crib? She said, excuse me, is this your baby? Yes. How did it get to you? The woman saw somebody left by the store, the carriage in Bnei Brak, everyone religious. She went quickly in the store. This crook took the baby out. She went into the store pretending it's her baby. She gave it to her. She stole the... Now the boss found out and he sued the girl, the saleswoman, in Beit Din to pay him for the menorah. Where do you think the verdict is? She's guilty or no?
No. She's guilty.
The answer?
No.
Next, like Ba Omer. She guilty or no? What do you say? No? Why she's guilty? All the Bukhari and Zir that scream not guilty, it's only because it didn't happen to them. It happened to them. The guilty, guilty, like they say in Israel, Abu Abu are guilty. The answer, not guilty. Why not guilty? She didn't do anything out of the ordinary. She works there. Who would ever imagine that a person will give his baby and run away with a jewel? Somebody offered you $25,000 for your baby, would you sell it? No. Even in Zimbabwe, they won't sell it. You know, in the world, there are millions of baby gets kidnapped and sold. Do you know that or no? They sell, there's a massive industry of kidnapping babies, and they go to different countries, make them fake IDs, and they sell them from one country to the other, and they never find them. And they don't know who their parents are. All it takes is 1 minute that you send a little kid alone to the shul in a quiet neighborhood. Okay, it's only one block, go. Some of the psychos that got arrested by the police, they told them, how did you know where to find the kids? They said, we waited by the shul. We always knew there's few young kids that come alone. You understand? You think you send your little kid to the shul by himself, you don't know what happened. They got nervous. He heard the story about the crib, she got nervous. Thank you very much. Hope to see you again. Happy Lag BaOmer, Kol Tov. Yeah, free CDs in the box, please. Free CDs. Free CDs, thank you. אני מסכים איתך.
How are you? Good. Baruch Hashem. My daughter listens to CDs every night before she goes to sleep. Every night. So I said, the producer. She's very, very, very proud.
Already night. From this age, she listens. Oh, wow. Very nice.
Thank you.
Hamuda.
הייתי, התקשרתי לך מירושלים, שאלתי אותך אם אתה יודע את המספר של הרב אדרת, באמת.
ערבית? אוקיי, רואי, חכה שהלדיס מייבי וולבו. If the ladies can excuse us for 10 minutes until we finish to pray, please. They can take CDs, wait maybe 1 minute. Hey guys, close the camera, 1 second.